Since April, we have uploaded new and sought-after courses, content, and tactical assets for your business into the BAMX platform. Not articles behind a paywall that only pontificate to you what you should think and do, but education that actually shows you how to do what you need in today's market. Every day, we continue to add more content into BAMX and our private Facebook community. Content that works. Content that our members have exclusive access to daily. It's why over 1,500 of you and climbing have joined us in BAMX. It's also why tomorrow's price is guaranteed to be higher than today's. That's called inflation. Do not wait any longer. Use code HOT and join the thousands of agents taking their business to the next level today. Use code HOT for 10% off. See you in BAMX. Since April, we have uploaded new and sought-after courses, content, and tactical assets for your business into the BAMX platform. Not articles behind a paywall that only pontificate to you what you should think and do, but education that actually shows you how to do what you need in today's market. Every day, we continue to add more content into BAMX and our private Facebook community. Content that works. Content that our members have exclusive access to daily. It's why over 1,500 of you and climbing have joined us in BAMX. It's also why tomorrow's price is guaranteed to be higher than today's. That's called inflation. Do not wait any longer. Use code HOT and join the thousands of agents taking their business to the next level today. Use code HOT for 10% off. See you in BAMX. On today's Hashi, I'm discussing what consumers think about the 2024 housing market, Realtor.com's top 10 markets, and institutional home buyers. Today is Tuesday, December the 5th, 2023. I'm Byron Lazine, and the Hashi starts now. Good morning. Welcome back to the Hot Sheet. Let me know in the live chat if you're joining me here live, which market you're tuning in from. I'm here back up in my Connecticut studio where I'll be finishing out the week with all of you. Hit the subscribe button and the bell so you don't miss any of our Hot Sheets as well as any of our live content that we go that we take when we go breaking news style. All right. Tis the season right now for a lot of projections, surveys and outlooks into 2024. Lending Tree is taking their part in just that. We've gone over a bunch of them here in the last, feels like 7 days or so, and I'm sure they will continue throughout the month. Lending Tree, a survey of over 2,000 U.S. consumers, has shown us that 44% of Americans believe the housing market could crash in the next year. Another 31% of those consumers are unsure. That is the majority of folks that they surveyed out of their 2,000 that either believe that there could be a significant crash or are just unsure, don't have enough information. I would argue that there's a mentality here that we're going from the consumer perspective that we must be heading towards what we experienced in 2008. That's the only way to correct unaffordability in the real estate market, even though in the history of our real estate market, that's only happened once when we had a bad, faulty mortgage product, when we had a mortgage crisis, which we're not experiencing, of course, today. What it tells me, though, is that there's not enough real estate professionals signaling the message, doing a weekly show, doing a weekly newsletter, reaching out to their database and providing the information. Why do we create the Hot Sheet back in January and stayed committed to it every single day that the market was open here in 2023? To arm real estate professionals with that data, with that information. Make sure, I'm imploring you, make sure you take the data and help educate folks. I know if you're a BAMXer, if you're a BAMer, you're doing just that. Because this is shocking that there's this many that are still, I guess it shouldn't be shocking because you've got a lot of misinformation out there. But a crash, when I hear crash, I'm thinking 20%. 5% off on pricing after 40%+ gains the last few years overall. It to me is not a crash. It is a trimming. It is an adjustment. A crash would be 15-20% in a 6 to 12 month window. What is surprising though is that, and you can find this full article on nowbam.com. What is surprising is that 35% are hoping for a crash. So 3.5 people out of 10 are rooting for the U.S. housing market to fall apart, to crash. Well, oftentimes, these aren't even the ones that are in position to create an opportunity for themselves and for their family. They're just negative Nellies rooting against the housing market. So it's an interesting mindset that people would be, consumers would be rooting against the market. But as real estate professionals, as people who pay attention to housing each and every single day, as we do here on the Hot Sheet, we should know what consumers are thinking. And 35% are so disgusted with the affordability in the housing market that they're actually rooting for a crash. They're in the stands, probably the bleachers, yes, and cheering on a housing crash. 44% believe it could crash. So out of these 2,000 or more that were surveyed, there's 52%. Here's the generational breakdown. 52% were millennials. So they've got this lending tree categorized. You can see different categories for millennials, but they have it as age 27 to 42. They're most likely millennials to expect a market crash within the next year. I'd argue that millennials are probably also the hardest out of the real demographics of buyers and sellers. The Gen Z isn't a real demo just yet on the forefront. So out of the actual generations that are players in the game, I would argue that millennials are the hardest to educate. Millennials do tend to not listen or certainly have that shorter attention span at times to listening to attention. So it's going to be maybe more difficult to break through to some of the millennials on this type of education that is needed. We certainly know if you've been, you can go back and watch, almost a couple hundred streams that we've done this year on the hot sheet. There's absolutely no indication that a crash is anywhere in our near future. In fact, yesterday we made the argument that if some of these projections are right, and Realtor.com projecting 14% drop in inventory, I would argue that prices are only going to go up. I mean, certainly if we continue to see the trend line of inventory dropping, simple supply and demand curve could make that argument. 30% of baby boomers, which is 59 to 77, have the same expectation. So 52% of millennials most likely to expect a market crash for the next year, only 30% of boomers. A little more experience, a little bit more knowledge of what's going on. They've seen a few more things. Almost half of the boomers, in comparison to the millennials, expect there to be a real estate market housing crash. After millennials come those Gen Zers, age 18 to 26, 48% believe a market crash. None of them have even been through a market crash. They don't even know what it feels like. They've never experienced one. Followed by 42% of Gen X, 43 to 58. Okay, by parental status, 55% of parents with children younger than 18 expect a market crash. Followed by 39% of those without children and 35% of those with children 18 or older. I'm paying attention more to the millennials and the boomers as I tend to right now. They're the two biggest demographics when it comes to buyers and potential sellers of real estate. Obviously, the two biggest generations, largest generations by population. But they're also, they've got the most skin in the game in the real estate industry. I see an opportunity with millennials being able to break through and give them a higher level of education. Boomers are already seemingly on the same page. There's 30% of them, though, still that do expect a market crash. But I see huge opportunity in the millennials if you can figure out a way to break through. If you can provide great value, if you can connect on their level, like experiences, maybe it's a wine and cheese, talk about the market, talk about the reasons why there's not a crash coming. Crash to me, again, is 15 to 20%. There's not a projection in the world that you can find that's looking at 15 to 10%. There isn't anything besides a banking crisis caused by a commercial real estate market meltdown that just evaporates banks in the country in 2024 that could create a residential real estate market crash. We talk commercial, the crash is happening. So, we got to separate the two. And maybe that's the way to, frame the art, frame the education, frame the webinar, frame the wine and cheese event. When you've got a group of people in your database in front of you, it's, hey, there is a crash happening in commercial. Here's what's happening in residential. Here's why a crash isn't coming. You know, look at the lending standards from yesteryear, the Great Financial Crisis and the changes they did in 09 through 12 and where they stand today, how hard it is to get one of those mortgages. 44% again, yeah, the housing market is going to crash. Homeowners out of this category were a little more likely than non-homeowners to think a housing crash is likely in the next 12 months. Interesting. Homeowners, 46% versus non-homeowners, 41%. By the way, all the charts, all the data, we'll drop it into BAMX, make it easy for you to do a daily download. I've been teasing about the show notes. We're going to do show notes starting on Monday. We're going to start giving away show notes for all the BAMX members. So I know some of you in the comments are like, hey, I want these show notes. We're going to start making those accessible to all BAMX members. You can use code HOT to get 10% off if you're not a BAMX member. You will take these show notes. Every single day, we're going to give you our show notes. By the way, the show notes look like this. We do this for every show. So you'll get it every single day if you're a BAMX member. You'll be able to take those show notes and create the education you need to deliver to your database, to these millennials or to Lenny. It's coming on Monday. So show notes for BAMX members. If you're not a BAMX member yet, get in there, code HOT, to get 10% off. So you'll get the show notes every single day. My advice would be to take those show notes, do a weekly show, pick two of the 15 to 20 topics that we do as your macro topic, one local. There's your weekly show, your newsletter, your Instagram carousels, whatever content you're pumping out right now to help educate these people who are, a lot of them are really misinformed. See how many followers that YouTube account Reventure has, who's been calling crash since the end of 2019, cost a lot of folks a lot of money. Telling people not to buy in 2020, when in 2021, when mortgage rates were, you could get one at 2.75. It was the easy button for buying in real estate. You'd have to be a dummy not to see it. Well, apparently he's got a lot of, you know, people that are want this bad advice that they're following him. It's crazy. More than a third of homeowners and 35% of Americans overall express a desire for this housing market to crash. 36% of homeowners want the market to crash. I don't understand that one. Okay. There is sometimes a destructive mentality with some people. This is the LendingTree survey. So, you know, I'm not supporting these numbers. I'm just telling you where consumers' mindsets are. Reasons include 15% wanting a housing crash to lower property taxes. Okay. Another 15% believing it could improve market stability. So they think the market's out of control, want to get inflation down, want to get maybe the overall economy stable. Hey, if you're not leaving your house, I could see that argument. Not leaving for 10 years. Go ahead, let the market crash, get, you know, inflation under control, get my prices under control, get my business under control, get my ability to borrow money for my, you know, if it's a business owner, my ability to borrow under control could be an argument there. Lower property taxes. This is going to become a bigger discussion in 2024. Here's a projection from me. Here's a prediction, a 2024 prediction from me, not from realtor.com, not from Sirhan, not from LendingTree. Property taxes are going to become a big discussion in 2024. Biggest we've seen in the last 10 years. All these assessments are popping. I own a house here in Connecticut. What did I just get in the mail? New assessment. Assessment went up a lot. Luckily, it's the second lowest mill rate. We go mill rates in Connecticut. It's how they calculate the taxes. Second lowest in the state. That's why I bought in that town. I see value in low property taxes. I was in a very high tax town before that with an HOA. I said, this is crazy. I'm going to sell it to what I perceived was the top of that particular community's value. Got in probably at the near top of the market in the new neighborhood and in the new town. Did a full renovation. So bought under renovated value, did a full renovation, but bought for property taxes. Big discussion in 2024. See, the problem is those that are rooting for a market crash, it's not going to impact your taxes till what? Depending on where you live, may not impact your taxes year, 2-3 years down the road. That crash has to take place. Those values have to become what they are. Those new assessments have to roll out. It takes time. The time now in 24, why it'll become a big discussion on property taxes is because the assessments are catching up from the appreciation we've experienced the last 3 years. Let me know in your market if you think property taxes are going to become a huge issue. Views on the mortgage rates from this Lending Tree survey. So consumers, 2,000 American views, 2,000 consumers in America, their views on mortgage rates. Despite a significant drop in rates, 79% of Americans expect rates to increase for at least another year. Over half, 53%, are concerned that rates will remain high. There's optimism among Gen Z, 21%, that rates will fall between 5 and 5.99. I hope so, Gen Z. I hope you're right for once, Gen Z. Let's roll with Gen Z. While boomers, 21%, expect rates between 7 and 7.99. So boomers are, on the other side of that. They're thinking higher for longer. Now, I made the argument yesterday that we could get in the fives under six. If we had a normal spread on the 10-year to 30-year, and this is Logan Modishami says from Housing Wire, you get a normal spread right now. If we had a normal spread, Gen Z would be right. We'd be under 6%. What could create a more normal spread for the first time in the last like 3 years? The Fed could start cutting the interest rate, and you could start to see that normalize. That would be the fastest way to push this thing down the quickest. There's not many projections that say the 30-year fix will fall into that category. There was some just 6 months ago, not anymore. They've all bumped them up higher for longer, high sixes, some as high as seven. Half of homeowners, by the way, 50%, say the mortgage rate is keeping them in place. So this speaks to, I guess, Realtor.com's projections yesterday, where, you know, they believe there's going to be, you know, flat on the transactions. And at the same time, they believe there's going to be a price decline, but 14% less inventory. You can figure that one out. I don't know how you get a price decline on 14% less inventory, but 14% less inventory speaks to 50% saying, hey, this mortgage rate's locking me in. It's keeping me where I am. In order for folks to buy a home, 32% of them believe the only way to do it is with a market crash. 32% say, hey, only way I'm affording a home in 24 is if this thing blows up. And so maybe that's why you got some rooting for that. Americans most likely to worry about these mortgage rates going into the new year. Those with children under the age of 18. Household incomes of $75,000 to $99,000 used to be able to be able, you know, buy a home here in this category, no problem. $75,000 to under $100,000, it's real hard now. It's super difficult. If you're at $75,000 with the inventory and the rates, it's really, really hard. It can be done in some areas, but it's going to be hard. And then millennials overall, okay, are worried about rates. Also, women, 56%, tend to worry more about high interest rates than men. Well, they're just smarter than men, right? So, I mean, they're worrying about the obvious problem. Men are like, What's the rate? I just need to go buy a house. Do you think you'll ever be able to buy a home again in the future? It's an interesting question. 50%, yeah. So one out of two people think the future's bright like I do. They're optimistic. Yeah, I'll be able to buy a house. But 19% are unsure. 11% don't think they'll ever be able to buy a house. So 30% are either unsure or just don't believe they'll ever be able to buy a house. And 19% have just quit. I'll never look to buy again. They've just submitted to what Jerome Powell wants, a renter nation. They've just said, yep, I'm good with being a renter for life. That's what Jay Powell wants. That's what the US.gov wants to see. I'll deal with that. What are homeowners worried about when it comes to the housing market? What are non-homeowners? High home prices, high mortgage rates, homelessness, economic impact, housing market crash, low inventory. We'll drop all these charts down below. You want to use them for a green screen? You want to use them for, we'll drop them into BAMX rather. You'll be able to use all these in your newsletter, your green screen. Let's shift off of LendingTree, what they think, or the data that they accumulated with consumers, and go over to some more projections from Realtor.com. We looked at some yesterday. Now let's look at where they believe the top housing markets for 2024 are going to be. All right. They believe that there are markets that could see double-digit growth as some areas rebound from lows. So they've identified the markets that they believe could explode, could have double-digit growth, explosive growth. There are 8 metros that they've identified to have double-digit growth in 2024. Now, these levels remain below 2021, 2022 levels and pre-pandemic levels. Okay, except for one. There's a market they have above those levels. That's the number one market on the list. That's Toledo, Ohio. All right, if you're selling Toledo, I'd be using this as like the big news. Hey, we're going to have huge growth, bigger growth than during the pandemic. So this is on sales too. This is on transactions. Who would love to have double-digit percentage growth on transaction? 14% existing home sale counts year over year. Toledo, up 14%. I think every agent in America would take 14% tick up on total transactions. Toledo agents, do the Macarena. 2024 existing home median sale price year over year, 8.3% in Toledo. Then you've got Ventura, California at 2, Rochester, New York, San Diego at 4, Riverside, San Bernardino, Bakersfield, California, Springfield, Mass. In at 7, Worcester, Mass. At 8, Grand Rapids, Kentwood, Michigan at 9, and then LA, Long Beach, Anaheim area at 10. Double digit. In most of these areas, double-digit transaction count, all of them going up in price, according to Realtor.com. Affordability propels sales and price growth in top markets in the Midwest and Northeast. Okay, so they're looking at that Worcester, I don't know Toledo, but they're looking at that Worcester market, and they're saying that this is a affordable area. As of October 2023, all these areas except for Worcester had median listing prices below the national average. I would also consider Worcester for the surrounding areas very affordable. And that's what that's the argument they make here. It's 41.8% less expensive than nearby Boston metro area, which is much of its out-of-town home searchers originate. So you got to look at that surrounding area as well. But all the other metros had median listing prices below national average. So there you go. According to Realtor.com, more projections from Realtor.com. I didn't love all of the projections yesterday. but there's some more projections from them on where the top housing markets will be here in 2024. Well, it's been a hot topic the last couple of years, and we'll see where it goes in 2024, has been institutional buyers. We've dispelled it here. Many people believe institutional buyers. It's a common theme, just like this housing crash thing can be a common theme for normal consumers not paying attention, not being educated. There's this thought that institutional buyers are buying all the homes. Not true, obviously. But there's also a shift in institutional buyer activity right now, and it might not be the one you think. Okay, there's thought that, okay, market's high, interest rates are high, these institutional buyers are going to have to just start offloading all the properties they've bought. They're not having an institutional sell-off. They're actually just holding overall. Only 3 out of 21 major institutional home buyers are selling at least 2% of their portfolios at the present time. Most of them are just holding firm. Are these institutional buyers waiting for lower rates? You can't really argue that they're waiting for a better time to cash out on these properties. You know, there's a belief that home prices can go up next year. There's a lot more belief that it'll just stay flat. There's some that it'll go down. You're kind of rolling the dice if you're rolling the dice on price. You would argue that institutional buyers, if they were going to do a sell-off, it would have been this year. That there was, you know, the cards were stacked in their favor. We do finally see signs that inventory could tick up. You want to sell at the lowest inventory level possible when demand is still present, which it is. So you can't really argue that they're waiting to the perfect moment in 24 to do a sell-off. Are they waiting for rates to come down? Do they believe rates are going to come down and they'll just maybe refi or buy more? Are they so bullish on the rental market in the future for single family homes that they're like, why would I sell this asset? Shows you the strength of how Wall Street and institutional buyers believe in this asset class right now. If they're not selling, why should many Americans who own single family homes? Housing inventory for sale among institutional buyers. Only Vinebrook, Sylvan, and SFR3 have over 2% of their portfolio listed. That's only hundreds of homes. 545 for Vinebrook, 114 for Sylvan, and 185 for SFR3. Vinebrook's is the only one in the, but even over 200. Well, I get you got another one there. American Homes for Rent, 230 homes listed for sale. These are the top institutional buyers across America on this table. We'll drop it down for BAMX people to grab that if you want it. Not a lot of these institutional buyers, really none of them, are major sellers right now. Vinebrook Homes Trust owned 25,716 homes at the end of Q3 22, which is down from 27,211 homes in quarter four 22. So, little pruning. What were those little plants they used to sell in the commercials back in the day? I have a Gen Zer sitting here. She doesn't even know what I'm talking about. If you know the plant I'm talking about in the comments, is it a Fiji plant or something? You used to cut it with the scissors, a little, and it was like a home project. I don't know why people, I never bought one, but it's the pruning, the plant pruning right now. That's all they're doing. They're not selling them off. They believe in this product, single-family rental, even in the high interest rate. The little bonsai tree. Yes, John, the little bonsai tree. Should pull up a picture of the little bonsai. For anybody not familiar with that, the little bonsai tree. Here it is. This was like an infomercial. People would buy these like crazy. A genius who ever sold the little bonsai tree. What happened to the little bonsai? Anybody still bonsaiing out there? Tweet me a picture of it at Byron Lazine. In quarter two of 2022, institutional landlords, firms owning at least 1,000 homes, that's an institutional landlord definition, firms owning at least 1,000 homes. That's the institutional landlord. So you can own 100 homes in a town. You're not institutional. You're a local investor. You're a local landlord. So firms owning at least 1,000 homes or more. In quarter two of 22, it felt like they were buying so many because they were buying more than they typically do. It was only 2.4% of home purchases in that quarter, quarter two of 22, equivalent to one out of every 42 home purchases. So there was enough anecdotal local stories of, wow, I'm getting beat out by an institutional, felt bigger than it was. It was 2.4. That frenzy fizzled out once interest rates spiked. Okay, so the buying has dropped off. The holding is what's happening. In quarter three of 23, institutional landlords only accounted for 0.4% of home purchases, one out of 250. See how it flips with rates? That cheap money has helped more of these institutional buyers pick up rental assets. At the same time, the really high interest rate is pushing folks into rentals. This is why I say Jerome Powell, is he wishing for a renter nation? When you ratchet these rates up high, you cause people to go affordability route of rentals. When you make them low, you got a lot of investors scooping them up. They probably should be in a normal range here, right? If you look back on the last 10 years, what's like 4%, 5%? I think we could all find some solace in that market, 4 or 5%. Just like we can with, this is getting better by the minute. With where the 10-year is, it's cause for celebration here today. 4.17 on the 10-year treasury. 4.17. We're down below 4.2. I'm excited to see where the 30-year fix goes today. Yesterday, we ended at 7.11. We could now actually get a 6.9-something reading. We're under 4.2. We weren't under 4.2 yesterday when we signed off on the show on the 10-year. Remember, if we had a normal spread, we'd be under 6 today on the 30-year. We're getting good news here at the end of the year. We're getting good momentum on the 30-year fix. If you want to have a good 2024 and you want to get the most out of BAM, make sure you become a BAMX member. Use code HOT to get 10% off of BAMX. We're going to start dropping show notes on Monday. So if you haven't made the decision, there's your reason to get in. We're going to drop the show notes every single day for BAMX members. All right. I'll get our senior editor who writes these and myself. We'll do a live stream inside of BAMX. That's the other thing you're missing if you're not a BAMX member, is these live streams. And we'll break down the show notes, how to use them, how to produce them for your show. So that'll kick off on Monday. All right. Just for the BAMXers. Hope you guys appreciate the show. Make sure you subscribe and hit the bell so you don't miss one of our hot sheets or any of our live content. And have a great day till tomorrow or till 2 o'clock. So we've got the real word. Real Word Pod on the channel, 2 o'clock. So I guess until then, toodaloo.